first met was that actually the music industry and live music in India does, you just feel it, it feels male dominated. And, you know, what we then did was to try and kind of understand that, to test it. So we did a survey of about 3,500 women across Indian cities, including here in Mumbai, to understand what the real experience is of women going out at night, particularly to music venues. And, you know, when you hear from real people about the lived experience of what it is like to participate in nightlife, you begin to understand it better. So, you know, from that survey, you have real practical recommendations for venues, for people who have some ability to change things fast and change things over the long term as well, on issues that really matter about transport. How can you get to and from a venue as safely as possible? How can you work with transport companies to make people feel safe? How can security have training and have empathy training to understand the things that they see on those nights when they happen? How can you build a kind of an equal staff, you know, whether it's bouncers or, you know, barmen and women, security, venue managers being women, to help drive that culture? So, you know, I found it really helpful to drill down into what the big issues were to, as a way, as a starting point, to try and then do something about it.
And we're hoping to share that report soon, aren't we?
Yes, yes.
It's funny you say that, because we just had a panel in Dubai regarding similar topics, and something we touched on was how it's not just the promoters or the DJs that can make a difference, but also the audience. When people go out, yes, people want to go there, have fun, and have a great time, but it is so important to be aware of what's happening around you. And educating people to think that way via conversations like these is so necessary at this moment. One of the biggest outcomes of our conversation was that men, a lot of times, don't know what women are going through at a party or at a festival, or in life in general. They don't know about the harassments, because a lot of times women will walk away without saying anything because they don't want to get into a fight. And people aren't always aware of what's happening to their friends standing next to them. So just as partygoers, everyone looking out for one another, whether you know people or not, if you see something that's happening which is not right, or if you see someone uncomfortable, there's no harm going and asking them, hey, are you okay? And it's such a small thing you can do. Like Tom said, you know, training your staff, training your bouncers to recognize interactions happening on the dance floor, where they shouldn't have to be told that, hey, this guy's making me uncomfortable. They're bouncers, they're there for our safety. It's not just when cops come in or when there's a fight breaking out, but to actively watching what's happening in the space and noticing or picking out instances which potentially could be bad for the women or other people on the dance floors. So I think these conversations are so important, because it sparks a seed of awareness in people. And the more we talk about it, the more people will be aware, and it's the tiny things that matters. I mean, this is a start, and more things will come out of this. So just having conversations is important.
And sorry, just because that's really interesting, is that I think when venues or events have clear kind of principles and identities of how they are wishing to operate, it means there's a much greater likelihood that their audience are going to come in with the kind of expectations of how they need to behave, what is the culture of that night. And I think it ripples through then the atmosphere that exists on that evening.
Yep, absolutely. That's correct. And there's a lot of parties popping up all over the world where they promote their parties as safe spaces. And they basically say no nonsense will be tolerated. So you can't go there and be racist, sexist, or discriminate against anyone. And it's really cool that such spaces and such things are happening. Another concept that somebody mentioned in conversation, a friend of mine, was, and I didn't know about this till we had this discussion, there's something called safe words around the world, where if you went to a bartender or a member of the club or somebody working there and said this word, they knew that you were in trouble, and they wouldn't ask you questions, and they wouldn't ask you what sort of harassment took place or what the incident was, but they would straight away either get you out of the place and make sure you get home safe, or they would watch you with intent to see who is bothering you and then take action on that. And this is something I was not aware of, and maybe things like these can be initiated everywhere and in India.
There's a few places actually in Delhi who've just started doing that, so it'll be interesting to see. Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how that translates and how that transpires.
For me, it's been kind of a personal struggle not to be really angry all the time and not lash out, so sorry. But I've worked on it a lot, and I think it's actually been beneficial in the long run to not... it can be kind of an unsustainable state of mind to kind of lead with anger a lot of the time. It hasn't always given the best result, but sometimes it is the only kind of tool people have, is to be angry, you know? But for me, I've encountered some really like positive reactions, like from men in the scene. Like, I've had people come up to me and say they've never, a DJ actually, he came up to me and said he's never ever been booked on a lineup with a woman before in his whole career. And I thought that was just such an interesting thing that he was thinking about, you know? And I think just like those little bits of change, I think really affect the environment, because now he's like cognizant of it and now he'll think more about it. I know men DJs who don't play on lineups unless there's other women on it, which I think is also a really powerful statement like to make. So there are really small like effects like people can make, as well as like, you know, audience members like taking care of each other like that. It can come from the DJ, men DJs too, by like sort of protesting against it, rather it just being like women being angry all the time, you know? It can be really exhausting, that state of mind for sure.
And then the other thing is the importance of consistency and patience, because, I mean, in your experiences, kind of, I guess, the first couple of times you try something new or you try an inclusivity writer, maybe someone doesn't kind of, like, certain promoters won't kind of want to engage with that, but then slowly and slowly it starts to pay off. But and Frankie, I wanted to talk about patience, because that's surely something you must have had when you were quite key in supporting some legislation that passed in New York about like an antiquated law that was kind of prohibition era. So, like, patience, I mean, I'm sure.
Patience, for sure.
Patience.
Yeah.
But I think, yeah, just to talk about like how, you know, this like really persevering does pay off just generally. Yeah.
I mean, in that case, like, that law was around for 91 years, so I think patience really does pay off in that respect. Like, but actually, like, with that legislation, like, it'd been around for such a long time, and it was a no dancing law in New York City that was kind of introduced in like the 1920s as a way to sort of separate black and white communities in Harlem from dancing together, and it just continued on and on, and then whoever kind of was in government in New York kind of enforced it in the way they wanted. And Giuliani, who you may or may not know, he's a terrible person, he enforced it in really heavy ways that like really mess with queer nightlife in the US. And it's kind of been enforced casually since. And we, you know, after Trump was elected, a lot of people felt really sort of ignited politically. And this was kind of a one way that we could affect change. And that does kind of go back to, you know, kind of what we were saying before. There are little things that you can do. Like, sometimes, you know, taking on the whole world with these issues just seems so large. But there are really small ways you can kind of affect your community, like, even in terms of, like, just going to the party and feeling safer. And this was one way that we felt like it could... we could do something, and it worked in our favor. But there was loads of things that kind of like aligned in that way. We had, you know, a relatively more radical mayor than we did before, de Blasio, and, you know, a bunch of people wanted to sort of get behind it. And it just kind of worked out. And I think, you know, if you... It does, like, change doesn't happen overnight. Clearly, in terms of this law, it does not happen overnight. So you kind of just have to stick with it. And that's kind of what did. We kind of built on other people's work as well, you know?
Amazing. And then, Pooja, you were talking about like you starting to say no a lot more to gigs that don't work out for you or make sense for you, and the importance of kind of just being patient and sticking to your principles and starting to kind of stick up for yourself a little bit more.
I think being a woman, it's not always easy because people don't want to give you the same fees, or they think they're doing you a favor by putting you on the lineup, which is not true. I've been offered some ridiculous fees on basis of, hey, by the way, we're giving you a break in our city. And I'm like, okay, but that's not my worth. And male counterparts having done the same amount of work that I have done will never be approached in a similar way. I know because these guys are my friends as well. So,
but have you noticed, since you've been standing up more for yourself, that there's a change in the way people kind of approach you now as promoters and bookers? Like, has that kind of consistent attitude and kind of standing up for yourself starting to pay off?
It definitely has, because now the same guys, the same promoters or bookers, do come back trying to book me a gig, and they will ask, you know, what's your fee or what's your requirement, etc. And I think it was very important making that stand a couple of years ago. Had I said yes to those gigs, maybe the true worth of what I think I am wouldn't have been matched. And it's so important because we're brought up in an environment or in a society that has always sort of ingrained in us that we are lesser and we don't deserve as much, or you're a woman, so, you know, you got to work with what you get, and if you get something, you're lucky, and that's not true. And the more women stand up for it and say, no, that's not happening, I'd rather just not do the gig, and when you're ready to, you know, meet me halfway or meet me at least where it's fair, then let's have a conversation.
But it sounds also like, you know, a lot more male artists are also standing up and putting inclusivity riders in their contracts, and that's also hopefully helping the cause as well.
I think it definitely does. A friend of mine told me about an instance where they were trying to book a certain big name DJ in Finland, not even in India, and the DJ's rider said that it was a requirement that they book somebody of color or of a minority of some sort, and that was a requirement. And more people are doing that. More friends in the industry that I speak to are happy to put this forward, you know, to their agencies as part of their contract. A lot of people have these conversations with me saying, hey, how's it going? Is it really difficult? And as men, they may not always see what's happening or how women get treated in the industry. So they are interested, and they come and ask me, you know, how do you make things work, or what are the things that can help change? Is there something we can do? And that's really a great change and a way forward where men in the industry want to help women. It's a slow start, but it's a start, and that's great.
And something that I also wanted to talk about is, you know, it's very, you know, when we talk about, we take these stances as trying to kind of equalize music spaces and have better representation on lineups and in the music community. But then it's also, I think, really, and this is something you've spoken about a lot, Frankie, it's also very important to be consciously self-critical of your own actions and of your own language and of your own approach, and kind of reinvent the way that you kind of approach this.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, simple, you know, you practice what you preach, you know what I mean? You can't just sit on a panel like this and tell everybody what they're doing wrong, do you know what I mean? Because at the end of the day, like, we all are conditioned in a certain way to think certain ways. Like, even I, like, came in this with prejudices about women that were just ingrained in me, like we can't do this. And, like, speaking, what you were speaking about self-worth and valuing yourself and, like, being paid a lot is something that we deal with a lot in representing women as well. Like, most people don't know how to price themselves, and they think they're worth way less than they can get. And that's like a huge like struggle, you know, and that's definitely like something we have to kind of like work to kind of get over. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that's the issue of worth is extends into the arts sector as a whole, actually. And it's something we are, as the British Council, are kind of hyper aware of, because I think often what the arts sector suffers from is people asking for favours, of saying, oh, can you just help us out on this? As if it's a kind of, you know, art is a nice to have.
Right, right.
So our principle is always, you pay for your art.
Yeah.
So if people perform for us on their on our lineups, we pay them because they deserve to be paid. It's their job.
But have you seen that kind of ripple through to other organizations and institutions that you work with, that kind of by you making that example, that it's kind of...
Well, I mean, it's a process like everything else. And, you know, we will look out for, you know, being the best examples we, and being true to what we value first and foremost. And we're not intending to preach to others, but, you know, hoping that, it builds some kind of momentum.
And that's kind of what I wanted to talk about next was, you know, the proof is in your practice. So talking about kind of personal commitments that you've made as individuals about that have kind of ignited change that's around you, and kind of maybe any advice that you have for music professionals and artists about maybe small changes that they can make in their contracts and their ecosystems that, you know, you've personally felt have worked with your environments.
I think it's really important to sort of recognize, understand, you know, what privilege you hold in a space, and then from that perspective, try and see, look into the perspectives that you don't know, you know, and read about them, and listen to people who are different than you a lot of the time. Like, we changed a lot of our language around kind of gender from the beginning to now, and, you know, that comes out of kind of listening to people and how it wasn't, the language just wasn't expansive enough to include all the people we wanted to include. So we shifted it. And I think, you know, we can, everyone can kind of take those kind of steps by just like, listening is so important, and not sort of bulldozing your kind of like politics and agenda onto the rest of the world, but like realizing that criticism is not a bad thing, and actually is like a really essential building block to growing and progressing. If you care about people, then you'll listen to them, and that's just, you know, follow suit, basically. Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, for me, it's, you know, recognizing all those things, and certainly all the, you know, privileges that I kind of embody or hold, but you know, also just being aware of, you know, the things you kind of start with, and then, you know, trying to kind of reflect and evolve on kind of decisions you make. So, you know, my own is, I might not be on a day-to-day basis directly involved with the music industry, but I do lots of panel discussions, for example. So I wouldn't be on a panel if it was an all-male panel, for example. It's a small thing, but, you know, something I think is important. And, you know, as an organization, it's about knowing, again, your core starting point, but just that willingness to be there to listen, to get better all the time, and sometimes to be unafraid to make mistakes.
Just going back to what Frankie said, you know, it's so important to realize the position you're in, knowing you have a voice. Maybe 100 people listen to you, maybe 1,000 people listen to you, and it's very important the sort of conversations you have. Just being able to spark interest in these topics or being vocal about it. Like, my husband will always tell me, he's like, you know, why are you always going off on social media about these issues? And I'm like, if I don't speak up, who will?
Exactly.
You know, everyone's gonna...
The only way history is made.
Yeah.
History's only made when people are speaking up, like...
Yeah.
I mean, we can just look at any book, basically.
Yeah. like you can either put your head down and go about doing these things, you know, still fighting, still putting my foot down about certain issues, or I can speak about it, and more women who go through this will stand up and say, hey, this does happen to me, and how can we together move forward or come up with a solution? And not just women, even men joining in and saying, hey, what's the solution to this, you know? How can we change it? How can we make things better? So it's important to think of the impact you're able to have on people and coming out and speaking about things, and not just in the industry, in life in general. You don't have to fight battles alone. And there's a unity and strength, so the more people putting their heads into this, we can come up with more ideas. Not everything is going to work. Some things are going to just fall flat, but that's fine. At least we tried.
And I feel that, you know, with this conversation about inclusivity, I mean, we're majorly focusing on gender, but it also means that we're starting to scratch the surface with other marginalized communities as well. And I think that's also important to kind of note here, especially in India, when we talk about inclusivity, it's not really, we're talking about gender really, but I feel hopeful that this is also something that we can start to incorporate within our dialogues too, and by making spaces better for women, we can kind of start making spaces better for everyone. But I think that, Frankie, that's something that you're kind of definitely embracing.
And it's so different, like New York is such a specific place, and even relative to like other cities in the US, do you know what I mean? Like, we have a kind of a unique atmosphere where it's just so heavily diverse. There's just really no real excuse for not having things be diverse in that way. And the history is different. It's just different atmosphere. Like, you know, when we first started, when I was talking about language inclusivity, like our language wasn't inclusive of people who are non-binary and trans folks and all that kind of stuff. And like, we wanted to make sure that our platform was, you know, accessible to those people. So we made those steps. And, you know, everyone kind of has a starting point, but, you know, it's like one of those, you know, platitudes where equality for one is equality for all. It's like, it's all the same fight, I believe, you know.
Yeah, I mean, as you said, we have been talking mainly about equality from women's perspective, but in as my organization, our goal is to kind of create opportunities for people, and sometimes that is about opportunities to be seen and opportunities to be heard as well. And this isn't specific to music here, but for example, we partner with the British Film Institute in London to run an LGBTQ online film festival, which is running at the moment, called Five Films for Freedom. And that is about underheard communities getting a platform. And that is about those people getting a platform to be seen and heard in places where it's difficult as well. So where it might come naturally, these issues, where diversity is more easily possible in places like New York or in London, in lots of places around the world that is simply not the case. And you know, having something available and visible online, we have found, is a really useful way for discussions to commence.
Amazing. And then lastly, before we go into Q&As, wanted to just talk, I think this is something that you brought up a little earlier, Pooja, but the idea of, you know, if we are wanting to move towards more inclusive music communities, music businesses, in ecosystems, it's not just artists and promoters, and it's also about like activating, you know, empathetic and conscious patrons and guests, and you know, really it's all of our responsibility to kind of stand up and, like you said, to say something when we see something that's not right, and to look out for each other, you know, whether we are like on the dance floor as a guest or whether we are behind the console or organizing an event. So really, like, what kind of closing advice would you give to people, you know, as guests, as event organizers, as artists, that you can kind of, you know, to kind of instigate that action and instigate that kind of consciousness?
I think a good advice would be take part in these talks more often. Conversation is so important, because that's a way to engage people, hear what people have to say. Not everyone will agree to everything being said here, but it's important that we speak up. And, you know, if you're shy and if you can't stand up here and ask a question, have these conversations within your circles, with your friends. If you know people in the industry, tell them, hey, listen, we went for this panel talk and this is what was discussed, and you're my friend, you're an event promoter or a DJ, what do you think about this? And just get inputs from people. You'd be surprised what ideas can come up out of these. And you know, when people put their heads together, you might just, you know, be able to crack things that are just a big question mark in everyone's head. And everyone's like, oh, what can I do? You can do something. You just need to, just the thought, you know, when you question yourself thinking, what can I do? That's a start. So, yeah, that's my advice, you know, have conversations, really.
So my advice would be, you know, try and control the things you can control. So if you are, you know, have an initiative yourself and you drive the principles and of what you're trying to achieve through the programs that you run, and select a pro, which you lead so well, Sarah, I think a big part of that is around when it, so for anyone that doesn't know, select a pro is a all-female training program for DJ and production skills in electronic music, and it includes people who have some extensive experience in those things, but also people who are new to it. And I think what you do so well, Sarah, is create a supportive environment so that any kind of fears or concerns people have about how they are going to participate and progress are kind of quelled instantly, because they know what they're walking into. They know that there are people in the same position as them, and that it's a space that is designed entirely for people to be themselves and to try and develop their talents.
That's so sweet, thank you.
I think I'm just going to jump in and say a big part of it is realizing it's not about yourself. Even women in the industry, when you're doing stuff, don't think of it as what is in it for me. You know, when collectives come together, I saw it happen with EQA. Initially, some people who joined were totally on the platform of what is in it for me? Are you going to book us gigs? And you have to understand this is for the scene. This is for making things better for other people. And you will grow and you will benefit from it, but that's not your agenda. So I think the more you think of the scene or the culture as a unit, I think things will move forward better.
Yeah, I think, you know, similar, echoing kind of what you guys say, like we're all sort of individuals on this planet who can kind of really affect the outcome of what happens next in this planet. Like, speaking here, like as a black woman, like there's been lots of people who've come before me who've allowed me to have kind of privileges that I have now. And I feel like, you know, the work that we do is kind of like paying that forward in a way, and trying to create better spaces for the future for, you know, younger women to come up. And you, like, for me, that is a really helpful way of kind of understanding why it's important to do this, is that there's a cycle to it. Like, if people shut up and they don't say anything, nothing happens. Like, this world would be a very different place if no one did anything, you know? So think of yourself as powerful, basically.
thank you so much. We've got time for maybe like one or two questions if anyone wants to ask anyone.
So the question I have, at the risk of diluting this conversation, there seem to be silos like Bombay, Delhi, New York, where there seems to be an environment of overcorrection, where in an effort to be inclusive, we tend to resort to tokenism, where I would get booked because I'm a female artist. How do you grapple with the guilt of that?
It was a conversation I was having earlier where it's, there's two sides of the story. You know, gender disparity happens that way as well, where people want to book you only because you're a woman. Don't say no to these gigs always, because you're still getting a platform, you're still inspiring people. And don't feel guilty. What are you feeling guilty for? Hopefully more and more people will book you for the music you play. Maybe you'll get one gig because you're a girl, maybe you'll get two gigs because you're a girl. Honestly, it's only Women's Day where you see all-girl lineups, and I actually went out and asked the a couple of promoters I played for saying, hey, it's cool, you're giving me this platform and I'm thankful for it, but I look back on the history of what y'all have done and it's not so many women on your lineups, and why, you know? So when you take up that gig, go ahead, do it, but ask the promoter, hey, how often are you willing to book women? Or if you have a bunch of friends who play these gigs, open doors for them, tell them, you know, I'm glad the gig went well. Here's a list of people I think you could book and could work for your party. And you're still in a position of power, like she said. So yeah, there's nothing to feel guilty about. And you will sometimes be able to screen these bookings where you know it's just utter nonsense, and that's where you have the power of saying, no, I don't want to do it. Because sometimes they're just booking you because you're a girl for a holy party, and I play pretty solid, like hard techno, and when this booking comes through, I know it's a party I don't want to play, and I know it's something where I'm like, no, I'm not playing because I'm a girl, but do you get my music? Have you heard what I play? Have you done your homework? Ask these questions and things will change.
Yeah, I had actually a really similar experience to that when Umfang, like one of our DJs, she plays, again, really hard techno, and someone emailed us asking, they were like, can we have Umfang play? Yeah, we just need a set of like R&B classics. And I'm like, there clearly is a disconnect between, you probably haven't done your research, what she plays. And actually we had a booking last week where she got booked at some hotel or something, and the booker came up to me during the event and was like, can she play something a bit slower? And it's like, you are obviously basing your booking on her representing something that you want to be associated with and not on actually what she plays. And it's just so transparent, you know? But you can tell pretty easily.
I also, there are a lot of promoters who book their friends because they're friends with their, you know, they're friends with DJs. And I don't think their friends who are DJs feel guilty about being booked just because they're friends. So yeah, I mean, it swings around about. So I think women, we know, you know, we guilt ourselves a lot. We think of, overthink these things a lot. And I think, you know, what they've said is great advice.
Yeah. We're just overthinking people.
And, you know, when you look at it as a whole, my own view of it is that if there is an overcorrection, I don't see it. You know, in the UK, for example, it's a huge festivals industry. But you look at women's representation on lineups in UK music festivals, it's still probably less than 20% of a lineup. That's a problem. So when it's borne out in the whole, that's not something I personally have seen.
Maybe time for one more question, Prab?
Yep. So I was just wondering, what was that one moment where you went into a party and you were like, this is like the perfect utopian party where you want to be? And if you haven't had that moment, paint me a picture.
I think I've had too many moments like that, to be honest with you. Going to some Detroit events in Detroit have been amazing. Obviously going to Berghain a few times has been quite fun, to say the least. It definitely lives up to the hype. I don't know, there's been so many. We had some really good experiences in like Poland and Italy and Milan. There's this really amazing squat called Macau that's just like incredible. You should definitely look it up because it's an amazing space. That's so much fun. It's actually like annoying, to be honest with you. That's an annoying thing to say, but it is a bit annoying.
There's a party in Berlin, I forget the name, which runs on the concept of they don't do main acts on main slots. They pay all DJs the same fee, and sometimes they don't announce lineups at all. It happens in about blank. It's on the tip of my tongue and I can't remember the name of the party, but that's just really cool and inspiring to see because you just go there for the music. You know it's going to be great music, and they have a lot of women playing for their parties as well. They have a lot of smaller acts playing, you know, closing slots, and that's really inspiring to see because here they are giving people a platform that people need. I'm sure a lot of the headliners are tired of playing just banging sets, and here they get to experiment and play earlier crowds and work up the crowd and play music that maybe they never get an opportunity to play. So yeah, things like these, which are you know, off the beaten track and promoters and parties doing things differently, it's definitely very, very inspiring.
I had a kind of flashback the other day, which maybe will show my age when I explain it. But it was a gig at the Brixton Academy in London in, I think it was like 1994 or 1995. And it was a Prodigy all-nighter with Chemical Brothers and DJ Hype. And so I thought about it the other week when Keith Flint died. And the reason I remembered it was because when you're only sort of 13 or 14 years old, there is a... I just remember that euphoria of just seeing and feeling thousands of people simultaneously feeling the exact same thing, and how special that was. And there's some kind of gold in that, or an alchemy in that kind of experience. So, yeah, I've had others as well, but that was the one that just I was reminded of recently.
I guess for me, it's like any space that feels ego-free, where you know, any, whether it's a house party or a club night or a music festival, but you know, where you feel like you're in a space that's egoless and you can just kind of dance the way you want, and you know, you just feel uninhibited, basically. And I think, you know, I've had those moments at house parties, I've had those moments in India, I've had those moments kind of in lots of places. But yeah, I think we can have them anywhere we want. So yeah. And yeah, I think that's it now. So thank you so much to my panel. Thank you all
for
coming. And yeah, that's it.
Thank you.